Alicante, you may see guys like this one right here, soaring high above the sky like birds. And I've come here today to meet one guy who's taken paragliding to a whole new level. Mason is the guy that's brought us out here today to introduce us to parahawking. But first we have to ask, what exactly is parahawking?
Well, parahawking is kind of a fusion between falconry, the ancient art falconry, and paragliding, this new concept in flying. And it's basically training birds of prey to fly with the paragliders and harnessing their natural ability to conserve energy when we fly.
And falconry is your background, isn't it? You've been interested in birds of prey since you were very young.
Yes, I've been training birds now for 30 years. So I started when I was very young, when I was 10 years old.
So how did that interest first develop?
I was interested in birds as a kid, and I think I was actually interested in dinosaurs, but I couldn't have a dinosaur, obviously, and so I became fascinated with birds of prey, and then discovered this sport called falconry, where you can actually handle them and train them to fly. And I was very lucky. My headmaster at the time was an avid ornithologist, and he encouraged this interest. So and my parents as well. So I was that's how the interest kind of came about.
And you left the rat race of London and working life, and you travelled the world, and you ended up in Nepal, which is where birds caught up with you again.
Well, I went travelling to kind of to experience some different cultures and different life. I didn't expect to discover a completely different way of life like I did in Nepal, but having an interest in birds of prey, it kind of follows me everywhere. So I rescued a couple of black kites and rehabilitated them when I was in Nepal, and I taught them to fly with me, and in order to do that I needed to learn to fly myself. So that's how it kind of started.
So that's when you started getting into the paragliding?
Yes, yeah, I learnt to fly there, specifically so I could train these birds to fly with me. And that's how the concept of parahawking was born. And the name parahawking was actually sort of thought up over a few beers with my paragliding instructor.
And that was 10 years ago now?
Yeah, it was 10 years ago now, yeah.
And the work that you do over in Nepal has also got some very important reasons. You do a lot of conservation work as well.
Well, the idea is, with parahawking, is that we started to receive an awful lot of publicity worldwide. But there was, at the same time, there was very important conservation problems, particularly with vultures in Nepal. So I wanted to make sure that the publicity that I was receiving from my kind of experimental project, I could put that to some good use. And so I decided that I was going to focus all of my attention on making sure that the vulture problem was receiving some publicity, some much deserved publicity.
Is it literally just that the species is on the decline?
Well, the vultures, a number of species of vultures across Asia are dying out. They're dying out so much that we've lost about 99.9% of them. Now, vultures are very difficult to empathise with because everyone's image of a vulture is its head stuck in a carcass and it's covered in blood. But in actual fact, they perform a very vital and important role in our ecosystem, and they clean up all of the dead animals. So it's vital that we try and get the vulture numbers back up. Now, the problem with the vultures in Asia is that they're dying out because of a drug called diclofenac. Diclofenac is an anti-inflammatory drug that's administered to livestock throughout Asia. About 10 years ago, they discovered that diclofenac was actually poisonous to vultures. So vultures were eating the carcasses that had been treated with diclofenac, and it was causing liver and kidney failure and killing them. And it was killing them in their millions.
So how does the work that you do help improve their situation?
Well, we try and use parahawking as a platform to raise awareness initially, because conservation has to start with awareness, particularly with vultures. So it gives me the opportunity to talk about vultures and talk about the problems and talk about the importance of vultures in our ecosystem. But at the same time, it offers you an opportunity to come and take a flight with a vulture. We have Egyptian vultures in Nepal, to interact with them in their own environment, to understand about their characters and their personalities, you know, and to find out a little bit more about them and what makes them tick. At the same time, we donate €10 from every parahawking tandem flight towards vulture conservation projects. That money goes a long way in Nepal. We donate maybe about €4,000 to €5,000 a year, which goes directly towards specific conservation projects.
Now, Scott, the work that you've been doing has been receiving some worldwide international recognition, hasn't it?
Yes, we've been very lucky over the years to have articles in international magazines and newspapers, and we've even had Discovery Channel and National Geographic making some documentaries about us as well.
This isn't something that every other person is doing, is it? This is quite unique and something that you've developed.
Yes, so we've been lucky that nobody else has tried to copy, but we are still the only people doing it. And I think that's part of the appeal, is that people can come and they can do this once in a lifetime, completely unique activity that they can't actually do anywhere else.
And you're only here in Spain 6 months of the year throughout the summer. You're here now. How's it going for you here in Spain?
It's a challenge. It's very different from Nepal. We live in the mountains in Nepal. Here, we live on the coast. The flying conditions are very different. But it's one of the most consistent places in Spain, so which is one of the reasons why we're here. We want the opportunity to be able to offer parahawking to a wider audience. So even if you're not really that interested in flying or not that interested in birds, we want to bring that experience to you so you can have a greater understanding of the birds. And also gives us a chance to talk about the vulture problem as well. Even though we're not specifically using vultures here, you know, we believe that having the interaction with the birds provides a greater understanding of birds of prey in general.
So what birds will we be using today?
We're going to be using Harris hawks. And Harris hawks are the very famous birds nowadays in falconry. Very popular bird. Probably one of the most popular birds for falconry. Because they've got a reputation for being very easy to train, and they're very efficient hunting birds. We're not using them for hunting, but I wanted to show a different side to Harris hawks. I wanted to show people how versatile they are, and this is what we're trying to do with our Harris hawks.
It really is a unique experience, isn't it, for people here in this region to get up there and just experience a completely different thing.
Completely, yeah. I mean, a lot of people dream of flying. A lot of our passengers in Nepal dream of flying. They also say, oh, you know, they dream of flying like a bird or with a bird. Now, we can provide that opportunity, and we are the only people in the world who can do that, and it is a completely unique experience. Even for myself, I've been flying birds for 30 years, and now I've been parahawking for 10. I get the same thrill and the same buzz every time I take one of my birds for a flight.
So this is the closest thing we're going to get to experience what it's like as a bird.
I think so, yeah, because you can literally see the world through their eyes, and you can experience you know, the interactions and the way they fly, and you can see the bird, and you can see every movement of the bird's feather, and you can see the, you know, the expressions on its face. You can't do that from when you're on the ground looking up. You can only do that from when you're in the air and you're flying with them.
So tell us about the mechanics of it. Today, when we go up there as a tandem flight, how does it all work?
Well, we're going to have a briefing on the takeoff, and we're going to talk you through how we take off, get you strapped into the harness and everything first. And then we're going to take off, and we're going to fly along the ridge there, get some height, and then we're going to come back over this way, and that's when the bird will be released.
Okay.
You will have some food and a glove, and I'll have a whistle. And as soon as we've got some height, you'll see the bird climbing up, and she'll probably actually go a little bit higher than us. She's using her natural ability to conserve energy to gain height. So you'll see her just gliding on the wind and the thermals. So that's a very important part of what we do, is to try and sort of display their natural ability to conserve energy. She'll go above us and we'll call her, and then you put your arm out like this, and then she'll come down and gently land on your hand for a reward.
So while they've been hand-reared, this is a natural process for them?
Yeah, well, they actually haven't been fully hand-reared. They were reared by their natural parents up until they're about 16 weeks old. And then we've taken over the training from there. Their instinct really is to survive and to conserve energy. What we teach them to do is to be obedient in the air and to encourage their natural ability to conserve energy.
So who is it suitable for? Who can actually go up and try parahawking?
Well, anyone can actually be a passenger. I myself am a pilot, so I'm trained as a paragliding pilot. So if you want to try paragliding and parahawking as a solo pilot, first you have to be a master falconer, and then you have to be an experienced paraglider. As a passenger, you can be 6 years old or you can be 86 years old. My youngest passenger was 6 years old, and my oldest passenger was 80 on his 80th birthday. He told me it was the best thing that he'd ever done in his life.
Wow. So, Scott, you've explained it all. I think it's now about time that we got the gear on and we went up there.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, definitely. Let's go.
Okay.
Fingers crossed. So this is the fellow that we're flying with today.
Yes, he is, yes. His name is Jekyll, and he is a Harris Hawk. He's 1 year old.
And what happens when they're actually up in the air? Because it's quite, yeah, you've had to sort of train them, prepare them for today's flight.
Yeah, basically we train them to be obedient to us in the sky. We feed them during the flight, but essentially they are as free as a bird. So we're harnessing their natural ability to conserve energy when we fly. Now it's in their instinct to conserve as much energy when they fly. And so we'll allow him to go off and find the areas of lift. And then we'll see him climb above the gliders. So all the time he's using the updrafts and his own ability to conserve energy. And then when he's above the glider, then we'll call him in for a reward, and you'll see that he'll stoop down to the glove and he'll take some food from your outstretched hand when we're on the glider.
So can we get kitted up and get
yes,
up there?
Yes, definitely, yeah. Yep, I'll just take him back.
Okay.
So this is your harness. Mm-hmm. It's going to go on like a jacket like this.
So I'll be in like a seating?
Yeah, you will be when we fly, but for the takeoff it just sort of hangs off your shoulders. Okay. But it keeps you nice and secure. That's it. All nice and secure there. Okay. So I'm going to talk you through the takeoff first, okay? So you're going to be standing in front of me like this, and you're going to be attached to me by these two carabiners here.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to be behind you for the takeoff. Now, when I say one, two, three, go, okay, I want you to start walking forward.
Just literally walking?
Just walking, yeah, but you're going to feel the wing pull us back quite a lot, okay, because of the wind, all right? Mm-hmm. So if you go back with the wing, I control it, and then I'm going to say, okay, run, and then you keep running until your feet leave the ground.
Right.
So you're going to have a glove on your left hand, and inside here we've got small pieces of buffalo meat that we feed Heckle when we're flying, okay? As soon as we're flying, okay, get nice and comfortable in your harness. As soon as you are, take one piece of food, put it in between your thumb and your forefinger like this, make a fist, and then I want you to cover the food with your hand. Their eyesight's very good, and they can see food from a long way away. So if you've got food on display, you're going to have a Harris Hawk on your lap during the flight. All right, so keep the food covered and allow her to do her thing. As soon as we're ready to call her in, I'll blow the whistle two times, okay? And then that's your cue to put your left arm out, like this, as far as you can go. She'll come and land very gently, land on the glove, and then take the food. Just remember to relax and enjoy yourself, and enjoy the bird as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's key, you know, because that's what we're doing, to enjoy her, watching her fly.
You can do that anytime, but it's with the birds.
Yeah.
I'm ready. Let's do it.
We'll be right back.
rise up, we'll meet again. Rise up, rise up, rise up, rise up, for my mind and my brain. 'Cause I try to fly so high.
How was that?
It was, I don't know, there's no words to describe it, which isn't helpful, I know. But you've got this massive force of the wind, you can feel the power of it,
yeah.
And yet you're doing nothing. It's like you're just floating, you've got these massive sort of like predator of an animal, and yet it just lands on you, you barely even feel it. You know what, it's not, it wouldn't have been on my things to do before I died list.
Yeah.
But you know what, get it on that list and get down and do it. Yeah.
Well done, I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Thank you, it's been fantastic. Excellent.